I discovered Morley really in the 70s. And I got to tell you, I have them all. I got the big vintage ones. I got the Phaser, the Power Fuzz Wah, the Power Fuzz Volume. They're everything they've got. And I don't know, there's just nothing, the sweep on all Morleys to me, basically, with all due respect to everybody else, it just wipes you guys out. And the fact that it's switchless, I have no idea. And thank God it's you guys that just keep doing that. But to me, it's just pointless not to have it any other way. Like I said before, you can operate it with your hands, your elbow on a table. You could jump up and down with your feet. Morley did a superb, fantastic job. I highly recommend for all you guys who are looking for wahs, especially Brandino and I, we're bass players. I know that, you know, guitarists have been using wahs for years, and maybe bass players, it's not that common, like guitar players, but I assure you, it's not just a wah. It's not about just going wow, wow, wow. It's a filter. If you move very, very slowly like this, as you're playing some kind of thing, as you're cycling through it, and then you slowly let it back up, guess what happens? It's like you got a filter pedal going on, and it's not a wah anymore. It also falls into natural sync, right? Instead of being sunk up to MIDI to try and lock an effect, imagine that all you got to do is stomp to the beat of whatever it is you are playing, and guess what? It's like you got some MIDI lock stuff going on. I also want to say that I know a lot of you guys like to put the wah before distortion, but me as a bass player in Brandino, we like to put it after distortion because it bends your distortion or your fuzz. Mm-hmm. You're getting that pwow, and you're not going to get that pwow the other way. So I want to really give a big congratulations to Morley for really bringing it up to the next freaking level of wahism. And they've been here for a very long time, 50 years. What do you got to say, Brandino?
You forgot to tell him. When we did the duet,
yeah.
When it was happening, I was trying to get a different sound. So what he was talking about when he was opening and closing the envelope, what I ended up doing is finding a place. Oh, this is one that has spring on it, huh?
Now, you could play with your heel, you could play with your big
well,
toe,
or
you could
play. That's how I play, because I do like almost like a kick drum. Yeah. And a lot of times when I play, I do. And do that, and just do that with the drummer, and just see what effect comes out. But it's the bottom line, I'm doing the same pattern that he's doing. You know, and I'll be trying to keep it kind of locked with it. And I don't know what's going to happen, but whatever happens, it's going to be some natural stuff and some stuff that nobody would think about, because you're not thinking, you're trying to about wow, like you, but you're not trying from a rhythmical aspect. So by even doing that, it changes the whole spectrum.
The whole spectrum.
That comes out. But the point I wanted to make on that, when we did the duo, I knew he was going to go crazy with the pedal. So I said, instead of me both going, and we're just going like, everything's bouncing off of each other, right? So one wah is going to cancel the other out. I use it as a filter, because what I did, I had about down halfway, and I just kept the groove. So I used a Warwick bass with a pick, and I played an underline. So what it did, it had a tone to the bass that's shaped in the wah-wah, but I didn't wah-wah. I let him wah-wah. So basically, but it changed it so that you could hear two distinct with different sounds, and you could see I was playing the bass part while he was doing the other stuff on top of it. And that was the difference by you being able to know how to use the pedal, especially with two bass players, so I didn't cancel him out. I had a certain sound and let him do it on the top end.
I love what you
kinda
did.
So we kind of orchestrated. That's how it came out. So everyone, Brad, you know, I never seen that, you know, you've been playing this bass. I never seen you play with a pick, but I said, well, that was a style of music I needed to do. But did you hear how the bass sound different? Because they know how my Warwick bass sounds, but it sounds like a whole nother thing.
And I got to tell you, I love what you did. And if you guys haven't seen that video jam of Brandino and I on this particular song he's talking about, you must go check it out, because it's two different basses. He's playing the bass line and rocking it out with a filter style, like he says. And I'm playing my Music Box 8 string. And what I do is, when I play with him, I usually take the kind of keyboardy effect approach, ambience, And I got to tell you, I personally cannot live without these things. It has always been part of my rig. And as far as I'm concerned, you're nothing without a freaking wah. And these are the wahs that you need, period. You're like, nobody says period like you say that for me.
Well, like you always say, try one, you'll love it, you'll buy it. That's all I can say.
We've been hanging out here at the Morley Suite. Brandino.
And Momo. This is the Brandino Momo Show with Morley, live from NAMM 2020.
Right on.
Dig it.